I won't do that one again.
How was your day? Everybody. Stretch for me real quick. Can
I've
you
been
do
it? So long, been trying this shit for years. And I got nothing to show, just climbing this rope right here.
All right.
And if there's a man upstairs, he kept bringing me rain. But I've been sending up prayers and something's changed. I think I finally found my hallelujah. I've been waiting for this moment all my life. Now all my dreams are coming true.
Well, guys, I hope it's been a great day. How was your second roundtable? Pretty amazing. What did you learn in that one? Come on. Learn anything? Everybody's like, I'm tired. Well, I've saved some of the coolest things to the end of the day. To get ready, could everybody pull out your smart device? We're going to be using it momentarily. You know, I want to promote creativity in the classroom. And have you seen a thread all day that we're really not trying to just teach the old-fashioned way, but more creative, more innovative? Well, let me start it with this way. You know, nowadays, we're very sure that no matter what the student's pathway is, they're going to see more and more technology in their fields. There's no doubt to that, correct?
Absolutely.
I want to show you in Japan, 7-Elevens are even more common than here. I've been to Japan a couple times, and literally, it's kind of like, you know, on every street corner, there's a 7-Eleven. Well, recently, they've upgraded their 7-Elevens, and they're a little bit different. They actually use facial recognition. Let me show you. So, you initially will take basically a selfie of yourself, make an account at 7-Eleven, and when you enter the store, you don't have to stare at anything, it looks at your face. There is no one working in this store, but there are cameras. And what happens as you shop for your food in the 7-Elevens, there are many of these now in Japan, that it's automatically, whatever you take out of the store, it's now yours. It's not even possible to really shoplift because if you don't have an account, it doesn't let you in the store. So no matter what you get, when you walk out, it already has deducted it from your account. We've already seen this in this country, Amazon To Go in Seattle. We showed it last year. And now, Amazon has bought a certain grocery store. Does anyone know it? You have one close by. Whole Foods, Whole Paychecks. Do you see a plan here? They plan to put this in their store in the next 18 months. Now, you can just use your Amazon Go app, not your face just yet. So you're starting to see this new boundless way that technology will be used in almost every environment. So let me get you started today. Everybody grab your smart device. This is hands down favorite, the coolest thing. People are going to be so upset they left. So thanks for staying. I want you to download a free app. This will change your world. I mean that. You'll see what I mean. I want everyone to find Flipgrid. So you're going to go to your app store. If you're on the Android, you go to Play Store. If you go to the iPhone, of course, you go to your app store. I just read during lunch that there's a big announcement coming from Apple tomorrow about a tablet and possibly a computer. So I mentioned Android this morning, so let me mention the Apple side of the house too tomorrow. So who knows what it is? I'm not absolutely sure. So we'll have to see what that is. But for today, everybody, we're downloading, what's our free app that we're downloading?
Flipgrid.
Now, sooner or later, after you download it, we'll be requesting a 6-digit character. I will be giving to that momentarily, but if you see that screen, you're in good shape, okay? While you're waiting for it to download, once again, we're downloading Flipgrid, everyone, if you're just joining us. And let me show you what it is. Now, don't forget, our students have grown up with facey, you know, selfies, showing their face, Snapchatting. This is their environment. Well, everybody, look up right now. You've got to see what this does, and then we're going to try it live.
a video-based discussion platform to fuel engagement in schools and organizations. Use video the way your students use video and build an active social community in your classroom. Flipgrid is simple. Create a grid for your classroom, a project team, a conference, or an entire organization. Once your grid is created, add a topic or two to get the discussion started. Students record videos and respond to a topic from any device. Finally, users can view and reply to each other's videos and build an active learning community. Lock your grid with a secure password or leave it open for ease of access. Moderate your grid to preview videos before they're visible to your community.
For that one student.
And embed your grids, topics, and individual videos to any blog, classroom website, or learning management system to take your discussion further. So, how will you Flipgrid?
What do you think? So, we're gonna try it today. Let me set this up. I'm gonna do mine first and then encourage everyone with a device. And if you have a neighbor who does not have their device with them or it's not working properly, maybe you could share your phone just for a second if they want to try it too.
A video-based.
So now what we're going to do is, after we do this, I'm going to show you how did I set it up. I'm going to show you every piece and part so you're comfy with it. So what I do in my class is, let's say on Monday, I'm going to be introducing the topic of how virtual reality is changing the medical environment. You with me with my topic of discussion? It could be anything. Now, typically our students walk into class on Monday, and even though I've told them what we're gonna be covering, it's my objective and all that lovely stuff, let's face it, they come in and are like, we're doing what? Huh? Okay, I have no idea. But how about if I would have assigned a 2-minute video about how virtual reality is now being used in surgical units, and then ask them to make a 90-second video on what they've learned and take a little time to keep looking things up online to add more to the research. They would see everybody's response, and then we come in class Monday, I would start the class with some of that information. I might even learn a thing or two. And now we can have a discussion together because we actually have some precursor knowledge about the topic. Making sense? So here's what we're going to do. It's going to ask you for a 6-digit code. Now, if you want to type it in with me, but then I'll shoot my video, show you what happens, and then you shoot yours. Make sense? So everybody, when it says enter a flip code, everybody, do you see at the bottom of my slide? It's DEF9ED. And it's always a different 6 digits. So I've never seen one repeat just yet. Now, if you've done things properly, what does it say on the next screen? That's us, Long Beach City College event. All right, so we've got it. So let me say, if you look at the word more, it says, do you all see where it says more? It says, introduce yourself and something new in your educational world. Now, if it really were an assignment, I'd go back to that topic of the video. But notice, there is a video loaded inside of Flipgrid. It is an actual video about virtual reality. You say, where'd you get this video? Did you make it? No, no, no. I found it on YouTube. Just put the link and I'll show you how. It could be video directed. Do you see it playing? Or you might leave the video out entirely. It's up to how you want to go about it. You could just ask them, look up how VR is being used today in the medical field and let them go straight at it. But sometimes giving them some pre-information helps frame it because they might think VR means very ridiculous, okay? So I want to make sure I'm at least in the right palette. So I've watched the video, let's say, and now I'm going to shoot my video. Everybody look at my phone. I'm going to kind of point it down a little bit. Now, ladies, when we shoot our video, why do we want the phone a little bit higher than we are? I'm not sure. But anyway, okay, I'm hitting the little plus sign, and it's going to let me focus. Now, eyes in the upper two-thirds. It just makes a good video. If not, you have all this empty space behind you. So I'm going to introduce myself and tell something new at my school. So let me do that. Hey, I'm Corinne Hoisington, and thanks for coming today. Some great things at my school is we're using a lot of Oculus Rift and HTC Vive. I stop it. It will replay it to make sure I haven't said blah, 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 who knows what. Okay. You know how as teachers, even though we do this all the time, there's something about when you know a video camera is pointed at you, it's like, now, After that, I hit the green arrow, and then it will let me take a selfie. Why? Don't you hate when it grabs a random second of your video and you have this face? I am convinced on every school flyer, I look like something dreadfully is wrong with me. So now I can actually pose. Okay, here we go. And then let me head to Flipgrid. It's going to ask me for my first and last name. It will ask you email address, but it's optional, so just first and last name. You're about to shoot yours in a minute. So let me just open now to Flipgrid on my computer. And notice, in just these few seconds that we were just there, we already should have some feedback here. So let's see what, oh, Brad, you're ahead of the game. I'm impressed. You're in early now. Let's see what we have so far so you can see what happens.
Hey, I'm Corinne Hoisington, and thanks for coming today. Some great things at my school is we're using a lot of Oculus Rift and HTC Vive.
Gentlemen in the back, do you see what I see? What did you just see? What was at the bottom? Close captioning automatically.
We're using a lot of Oculus.
That's cool though, okay? What a good glaring sound. Everybody look one more time. Do you see the closed captioning? But look what happened.
Hey, I'm Corinne Hoisington, and thanks for coming today. Some great things at my school is we're using a lot of Oculus Rift and HTC Vive.
By the way, no matter what mobile device I'm using, it always thinks my name Corinne is Korean.
So that's typical.
Everybody know what to do? I'm going to walk around and help people. Could you help others? Everybody, we're going to shoot anywhere from a 10-second to a 90-second video. Go.
What's the code again?
Oh, at the top, DEF9ED. Can I help?
Trying to get that code again.
Yeah, up there. DEF.
That's what I put, DEF.
9. ED.
ED. And then I put that in.
And go.
Go, right?
Do you have the Flipgrid app? It looks like the web page. But no, it looks good. Okay, now we're good. Okay, now hit that big plus sign.
Hit this?
Mm-hmm. Oh, these videos are going to be good.
Video.
You didn't have a video?
No, I just it goes only for a picture. It doesn't go for a video.
When you hit the plus sign? Did you download the Flipgrid app? So there's the video.
Yeah, I do the
so
video.
So it's recording right now.
I do the recording. Hi. Yeah, hi.
And then we hit the stop button.
Stop, and then I go here.
And then it plays
it doesn't
back.
Go.
It's going. Your mouth is moving. Are you ready for your close-up, Mr. and Ms. DeMille? Now, I love that people grouped up together. Could be mob mentality, we'll have to see. Let's play a few. Okay. No closed captioning for obvious reasons.
I'm here to invite you to my class, COS50. Thank you very much.
There's a lot of laughter in the room, but we're just playing around. Uh-oh.
I think we're recording. Pepita, smile. Sammy, we are here. Long Beach.
Good fingers there, Kat, okay? Now notice, Scott. It's good. Good smile. Good smile.
Hi, I'm John, and that's all I have to say about that.
Good, John. Now, do you see how you can play him back on your side?
Hi, how are you? Good to see you.
Using Flipgrid in the classroom is great.
Good, Israel. Wouldn't this be a great way for students to introduce themselves?
Hey, how's it going? Professor Almeida, jplmeida.com.
Professor Madanuri, S. Madanuri at lbcc.edu.
Anthony Pagan, Professor A. AnthonyPagan.com.
A. Pagan.
A. Pagan at lbcc.edu.
You guys are awesome.
So let me just open now to Flipgrid on my computer. And notice, in just these few seconds that we were just there, we already should have some feedback here. So let's see what, oh.
I'm not really sure what happened there, but we're going to go with that.
Thanks for the fun day.
What do you think of this, Mr. Cinematographer? Isn't this pretty cool? Yeah. Very cool.
Hey, I'm Corinne Hoisington, and thanks for coming today. Some great things at my school is we're using a lot of...
Oh, she has a hat for tomorrow, St. Patrick's Day.
Hello, my name is Yolanda Touré, and I teach at Los Angeles Trade Tech College. I'm very interested in integrating new technology, social media, drone videotaping into my courses.
Very well done, by the way. She may win. And she knew clip art for tomorrow's St. Patrick's Day.
Let's play with you.
Hi. I forgot our phone.
We're learning. We're doing this.
Hi, I'm Casey Joseph. I'm with others here.
Hi, this is Kobe.
And we're enjoying the conference. Hey!
That was good. That was really well done.
Hi, this is Brianna Foxy. I'm the digital specialist for Cengage in Northern California, and I am so excited that I was able to join Corinne's session today because I learned so much every time I'm here, and I take that back to all of my instructors across the country when I talk to them about how to engage students in their class.
Thanks. She's a ringer. She's a professional at this. I can see that. Ringer! We had no idea we had actresses. What do you guys think? Oh, we got one more. Oh, Dan, go ahead. This is your big debut. Really well done. Now, let me give you some information. We'll show you how I set this up. Now, in real life, typically, it's an assignment. So there wouldn't be as much noise in the background, but it's okay. It's not, it has to be perfect. I'm hearing stuff. I'm hearing voices in my head. You can actually replay them and put comments and hearts and all these great things on your own device. You have the option when you set it up, if you want them to all be private, until you open them up. So that way they couldn't see each other's. If there was some type of an assessment that you really wanted, you know, unsolicited opinions. That way also, if you have, there's always two or three students that you probably teach that you know, how do we put it, aren't just funny, but they go too far. I know you're not shocked by this. If you've taught 10 minutes, you've had this happen. I check those two or three students out before class time. Because I can delete them, because there are some things that just are not appropriate for my class. So just in case that can occur.
I used to get a lot of quizzes, weekly quizzes online when they are home.
Yeah.
That would be a great tool for teaching.
It would be a great tool.
For teaching.
Oh, yeah. So they don't know about it until now, but they have to be usually a teacher to set it up.
Yeah,
but.
I'm giving quizzes online,
Well, anything. I mean, all you do is open the video camera on your phone. Right. Yeah. I mean, anything nowadays, there's a way to cheat, right? Well, it's free. The only difference, there is an educator, like, paid version that allows you to do, like, 5 and 10 minute videos. I don't want that. I want my free 90 seconds because you always have that student who wants to tell you the whole life story, and it starts before birth. Okay. Yeah, it does beautifully. Canvas, Blackboard, any of them, because it's just a link, and you can put this in there. So let me kind of show you around, but let me show you this first, and I'll show you how I made these and how to set it up as a teacher. Now, a lot of instructors, even in online courses, are making these that people around the world can participate. You see what I mean? Mm-hmm. There is a teaching assistant who is working at the Palmer Station in Antarctica. I'm not sure of any place farther away from here. So what she does, so that she can make her research public, well, let me show you. Very cool.
Gets, a marine biologist studying aquatic life in Antarctica. As Laura documents her daily experiences on her grid, kids from classrooms around the world respond to her videos and build a connected community with Antarctica.
Hi, my name is Laura Getz, and welcome to Palmer Station. I am a marine biology major at Northeastern University, which is in Boston. I'm here on station to study fish embryos, which is insanely cool work. There's tons of stuff to learn. I'm looking a lot about how they grow and what that process is like for them. And we're also seeing what happens when you change parts of their environment. Please stay in touch and can't wait to tell you guys more.
In addition, students share their perspectives on weekly topics and STEM-focused questions connected to Laura's research.
Hi, my name is Jillian, and I live in Bristol. So in Bristol, Rhode Island, we usually have some pretty big fish sometimes.
Hey, Jillian, thanks for sending me a video. It was really cool to get to hear from you and hear about what fish are like where you live in Rhode Island. You probably have some really, really cool ones.
Flipgrid as a Q&A as well. So what do you mean? Well, you know how it is. One student sometimes asks you, and it's a really good question, but there's a lot of students who would never take the time or just feel uncomfortable in asking you online or even directly. So this way, I make it accessible to face-to-face and online students, and students can put up a video. I answer them. You can, you know, do as many videos in response. A lot of times, I'm not just speaking. I might be pointing back at my screen. Or showing, hey, here's the SAM code, and you know, or going through whatever they're asking about. And you can see how many people viewed the videos. And it's kind of shocking. One student's question and my response, you know, I have 200 students this semester, I'll get like 120 views. So that's really kind of telling me that a lot of students had the same question. Sometimes students just aren't successful because they don't take the time to keep asking. But sometimes I think, I always get that email that says, I hope I'm not bothering you. No, no, this is my job. You're really not. So please ask. Hey, let me take you through the process of setting this up because it's so darn easy. So everybody, I'm going to a website called flipgrid.com. And I'm on a PC or a Mac right now. Could even do it on an iPad. So go to a full-size computer probably. Go to flipgrid.com. And up here it says sign up today. What I like about when I click on sign up today, most of you already have a Gmail or a Microsoft Office 365 account, so you don't even have to fill in the blanks. You click the button and you're in. No cost. So now, after you do that, let me jump in. The next step is I'm going to now go back to where I started here, back to Flipgrid. So when you first start your Flipgrid right here, let me just act like I'm logging in fresh. So I'm at Flipgrid. I'm going to log in with my account. And it allows you to create something called one grid. Grid is just like the space that you identify whose class this is. So I have one that I use on the road and then one I use in a real classroom. You can create as many accounts as you want, really. And I just say, hey, this is Professor Hoisington's Flipgrid account. I put a picture of my college. It's just my spot. So think of it as your online resource location. And then after you create your flip, your grid, which takes 2 seconds. This is a picture of my school, and now I can add as many topics as I want. So let me make a new topic. I'm going to make a new topic that, what did you learn at the conference? So I can set it up to 1 minute and 30 seconds, but every once in a while you may want to do just 15 seconds, you know, if you want it cute, short, sweet. I had the students at the beginning of the semester introduce themselves. And they're mostly at home when they did the assignment, so it's really cool. They had lined up brothers, sisters, dogs, trucks, gerbils. I knew you had to get in everywhere, right? Whatever it was, and they kind of showed me their world. You know, that was more helpful than I could imagine. A lot of our students live different worlds than we live in. And it's hard for us to really relate. If we can kind of see that world, I think it makes us more, you know, empathetic and understanding of their success. And another piece, I don't know about you, but the older I get, I hate admitting this, but sometimes names are a little more challenging when you have 200 students all the time. Please nod at me that I'm not the only one. So now I watch those videos over and over again right before class. So then I can just walk in and say, hey, David, you know, how's that truck of yours?
Four gerbils.
Okay. He's quick. Okay, he's only got four. That guy had like 30, okay? Okay, you'll have to add on. So now I can put whatever my prompt is. Prompt is simply a question or stimulus text so they understand what the assignment is. So I might just say, introduce yourself, tell me about virtual reality. Give me something that you might put down, Dan. What would you put as a prompt in your subject area? What do you like about school? Whatever you want to do it, and it could be in your subject area, just generalize. So you put your prompt here, you scroll down, and look at some of the things you can add. You can record your own video. Maybe you want to give a short little snippet of a lecture. Typically mine is, let me explain absolute reference in Excel one more time. Some of you understand what I'm talking about there. So, I thought, by the way, if you didn't get to go to Mark Ciampa's event earlier, he showed me something this morning. You know what would be a perfect snippet, Mark? If you're talking about long passwords or stronger, do you mind holding the two things you brought up today? If you didn't get to go to Mark's session, here is a great way he explained it. He has explained what you're talking about there. Do you mind? I did not prompt him. That was amazing. Everybody, woohoo! I'll talk about, I knew I could put you on the spot. but do you see he could record that video? And wouldn't that be a nice prompt now to ask students, you know, what are some concerns about passwords today? That would be a great one. That would be a good prompt to get it started. Hey, you could upload a video if you already have one. The add a video is from YouTube and something called Vimeo. And pretty much almost every one of our topics, whether you're doing solving a quadratic equation in mathematics to, you know, understanding in the ER how to handle a case, you could probably find a pretty good YouTube. And that might be your prompt. The prompt could actually also be a quadratic equation that they have to solve and explain to me in English of how do you go about solving this. And maybe by listening to other students explain it, maybe it'll break through where sometimes they've heard only one voice trying to explain. So it's a really neat concept. Sometimes, do y'all see this one that says upload an image? Sometimes you may just want to show, he teaches cinematography, if you don't mind me talking about David. He might just show a picture of maybe a downtown section in LA and say, okay, how would you film this? Set up a storyline. I mean, help me. Yeah. So it might just be an image. So you could do a lot of different things. You can do attachments to this as well. You haven't seen that yet. Attachments might be an actual written assignment with specifications or rubric. It could be a Google Doc, a Dropbox, a OneDrive. It's really kind of wide open and free. Did we mention free? And fabulous. So now, after we've set this up, all we have to do at the bottom is hit Create Topic. I think I didn't actually put a prompt, so I'm going to say hi right here. So now it is ready to go out. And now you say, well, how do I start collecting? It gives you this 6 digits. Do you see at the top code 5E025A? I hate when it's a zero because it's a little harder for students. Sometimes I'll do it again just to get rid of the zero. But now students can put as many responses, it's unlimited. So whether you have a billion students, make sure you quit if you have a billion students, okay? Or just 2, now we can get this engagement and response going. What do you think of this? Yeah, awesome. What's the name of it again? Let's make sure we remember. How much does it cost? Okay. Give me 3 ideas of how you're going to use it that's different than what I've said, just to give everyone some different ideas and viewpoints. Icebreaker, love it, and it could be anything. Yes, for public speaking impromptu. You remind me of, I took a group of high school students, because I do dual enrollment, to a competition for speech. And as we were getting ready for the competition, I told the students, we've got about 10 minutes, let's do this. Everyone give your little elevator speech that you're going to do during the competition to go in groups of 3 to a random stranger that will listen to you and come back at the hotel, and then we'll go to the competition. Well, everyone's come back but these 3 young ladies. And I'm like, oh, man, where are they? Oh, they're high school students. I've sent them away in a hotel. This is probably not my best move. Finally, they come running back. And I'm like, where have you been? And they said, we were on the elevator. I said, why were you on the elevator? Well, you know how long it takes for someone to ride with us long enough to give my impromptu speech? And I went, I forgot to mention something. Yeah? It doesn't have to be done on an elevator. I really do try. But sometimes it's just not clear. So I really encourage you to use Flipgrid. Students, you know, it's funny. Sometimes when I give them, let's say, a traditional assignment, not everybody turns it in. But students have grown up doing this. It's one assignment they really don't mind. And they get a lot from each other. You say, well, a couple students will be funny. Good. I mean, that's what it's all about, showing who I am, being creative. We all shouldn't have the same answer. We all should be honored for our diversity and differences, not our commonalities only. So, you know, we live in a world today that as students grow up, so often we get the same responses. These are children who are asked a question. Name a scientist. Everybody, what are some scientists you would think of real quick? Stephen Hawkins, of course. Who else? George Washington Carver. Marie Curie. Very good. Let's see something.
My favorite subject in school is science, because you can invent all different kinds of cool things, and there's like no limit what you can do.
One inventor is Benjamin Franklin.
Leonardo da Vinci.
Thomas Edison. Albert Einstein.
Nikola Tesla.
Alexander Bell Graham.
Everyone always comes up with Marie Curie,
It's kind of a tough one.
In school, it was always a male inventor. I just realized.
Not everything is man-made. Ladies, we just haven't been making crafts. Look at this.
I guess so much, I didn't even know that stuff.
You're surprised because they only talk about Einstein and Benjamin, but you never hear a girl in a conversation.
So Courtney, Rose, Sophia, Jenny, it is our turn too.
To know that there were women before me.
It gives me like motivation that I can invent something and make maybe like a change in the world, and that would be really cool.
They say the one factor that when it comes to women going into certain fields, a lot of times women don't go into fields like STEM. And the reason is they feel that it's boring. And let's face it, that's who's hiring right now more than ever. Only 6.7% of women today are in majoring in STEM, which makes no sense to me. You know why? Do you know that in the United States, that 73% of high school valedictorians at private and public schools are?
Women.
Women. So I guess we're as smart as they. And by the way, 59% of college students, including in California, are? Then why such a small number? And I'm not saying there's only jobs in STEM, but a lot of them are. So, the greatest factor, they say, growing up is confidence. They say if you're doing an activity in class like we just did, or maybe an experiment or hands-on whatever, that very often in a class, the young men will step up and start to do. Often, my gender stays on the edges. And the reason? We don't like when someone tells us we're wrong, and men know this for sure. Our confidence is lowered. Let me ask every woman in here, and I think I know your answer. We probably have hundreds of evaluations of students each year in the college and higher ed environment. For most of us, probably 99% of them are positive. But which one do we remember the clearest? The one that is negative and probably very off base. I get them too. It's funny, we grow up and we kind of stay on the edges. When you're doing anything in class, if you see this happening, I want you to say, why don't you take this role? Both genders. Make sure we're all a part of it. Do you all remember a teacher taking a moment in your life, stepping up to you and saying, you're good at that. You're excellent. You really should consider this. Yes? I bet you could name the teacher. I could. Let's be that teacher. I know we're crazy busy. We have so many things going on. Every day, do not leave your campuses. Do not leave your online offices until you take a moment to recognize excellence. And excellence doesn't have to be the best student in the class. It's a student who is trying their best. Let's do that. Because I think they hear it and they listen to that. And we are teaching the next round of inventors. You know, technology is changing everything. You know, last night I came here, I checked into a hotel. But that process is even
real-time
changing.
Real-time data. There are a host of opportunities for the
this
hotel, travel, and logistics industries to plug into this digital ecosystem. When a loyal traveller touches down in London, she can enjoy a seamless transition from airport to hotel with the offer of a quick taxi pickup and can check into her room before she arrives.
I did do that part yesterday.
The hotel will be ready for her arrival and be able to help if help is required. Hello, Laura. The personal touch is always on hand for those who choose it.
I love that personal touches aren't gone.
She will already have a key because card keys won't be quite so ubiquitous. And we know her favorite light settings.
Isn't that great?
And how she likes the temperature set. What about plugging into social networks to understand your guests better? And rewarding their loyalty, personalizing local dining options, and what their friends in that city are up to. And if a guest would like a drink delivered, then we can show that the order has been received and how long it will take to arrive.
And you're not opening the door to the wrong person.
And where they wanted it. better yet, could get it to them quickly. You'll be able to measure and adjust the hotel's demand-side energy consumption and carbon footprint, helping the environment and managing costs through the collection of data with more sensors tracking the use of linen, toiletries, and water, constantly improving and fine-tuning the offer.
By checking out online, you're not waiting till noon or something to keep all the rooms clear.
What if they don't speak the language and need help booking a taxi and an alert when it has arrived? The digital economy is rapidly improving the customer experience with platforms connecting data to deliver personalized intelligence.
Now personalized, Neil, what are we doing at 4 o'clock? I asked for personalized service once I won here, and Neil actually is delivering, and it's nothing to do with gerbils. Please tell.
She has a 4 o'clock appointment for a pedicure.
And I'm not the only one.
Real-time day.
It's true. It will be on Flipgrid, okay. So before we leave today, I want you to understand I've been weaving a tapestry for you to kind of see something today. And let me finally pull it all together. All day we've seen that there's new technologies, new ways of doing things, more creative. We're seeing in a different environment. Well, there are people who are much smarter than I am that believe that 2018 is not just a regular year. They actually believe that 2018 might be the beginning of something called the Fourth Industrial Revolution. So what is that? Well, throughout our history in the States, we've had moments where jobs and how we went to jobs, where they were located, and what type of jobs suddenly changed. The first one, anybody remember like 1790? If you say yes, I'm surprised. But in 1790, for example, we had the cotton gin, we had railroads. It kind of changed location and how much hand work we did. By the second Industrial Revolution, we had manufacturing in the late 1890s. By the third, 1970, technology, computers. What would that mean? Let's see. We now see so many new technologies. If you haven't gotten in here, please do. It's just mind-blowing how things are changing so quickly. I always walk out of this event thinking, if I'm asked back next year, what would I possibly say? But never a problem. We've seen these industrial revolutions change how our students and our population worked. How about if 2018 begins the next? And what will it bring? No matter what field you're in, it seems like technology is changing it. And unless students really encompass it, use it daily in class, understand its implications, it's not just have and have nots, it's those who understand how technology can change their life and those who do not. It's with security, it's with everything that we know. I often see teachers not use any kind of assisted technology in class. You think it might be cheaper or easier, but now that we have, you can use everything, let's do that. Because it prepares students in every field to be that more ready for this. In our country, there's a website that I showed last year called Glassdoor. It shows the top 50 jobs in the US. They've updated it this year for 2018. All the jobs usually have something to do with technology, STEM, something or the other. In our country, only about 2% of our population is majoring in that who's attending a university. Of that 50 list, China, Russia, Japan, South Korea, of those who attend the university, 20 to 40% are majoring in that. Why? They see it coming. As a nation, as a gender, we need to see that it's coming. One last little technology and we'll close soon. This one just super minor, but it's really helpful. How many see every once in a while a really great video on YouTube? And then you go back to show it weeks later in class and you can either not locate it or it's just gone. Keepvid.com, all you have to do is paste any YouTube address in the website. It's free, it's just a web address. It downloads any video for you to keep on your machine for educational purposes and not any sales features. In other words, don't make money off of it. So this might be really helpful. I often, like in my online course, like Canvas, I used to put links to videos, but then the links would go bad. Well, if you download the video and put the video in your course, it doesn't go bad. A lot less work.
Question. Yes? You put closed captioning on those videos because I use that website, but...
Yeah, so keepvid.com. She asked the question about closed captioning. Well, some of the videos already have it ingrained in them from YouTube, but if they do not, let me give you one other option. Microsoft has a new site. It's called stream.microsoft.com. It's a location that I can store videos. Let me say that again, stream.microsoft.com. If your school is using a Microsoft account like Office 365, you just log in with it. What it allows you to do is, let me show you, it allows you to store those videos. You don't have to store them on your computer just in case your computer crashes. But here's what's really
cool. Your business is a community. It was automatically transcribed, which not only enhances accessibility, but enables deep search within a video. Facial detection helps you visualize where each person is and lets you jump to the exact moment that's important to you.
Did you catch that one more time?
Speech within the video is automatically transcribed, which not only enhances accessibility, but enables deep search within a video. Facial detection.
So in other words, if you said the word virtual reality, it not only transcribes it, but then it finds that word in the video to pick up at that moment. So Microsoft.stream.com, it's growing constantly. I have switched everything over to Microsoft Stream. So excellent question. Let me give you a last couple pieces and parts here. One of the things that's missing from getting students to go down the path of employability is often they know, I want to major in this, but I'm not sure what jobs are part of that. I'm not sure what that is. How many years do I need to go? Well, at Ed2Go, and if you would mind copying down the website on the right side of the slide, it's called ed2go.com/careers. It's free. What it allows you to do is type in a job or a major that seems interesting to you, and then shows you how to get there. In other words, you would need to attend community college for 2 years, possibly major in this, pick up these classes. It makes this much money. You know, not that money is everything, but we do like to feed our families. We're weird that way, okay? So therefore, it kind of gives you that pathway to get there. So make sure we're constantly in our fields talking about what are the job pathways and how we can move through them. You know, today we saw lots of different amazing things throughout our day. I want to take you to one more. It's called Zipia. Let me just head there myself. Let me spell it for you. Z-I-P-P-I-A. It's called Zipia. So often, a student will come up to you in college and say, hey, you know, what kind of jobs can I get by taking your course? And a lot of times, I only know the names of maybe what the students before them had. I don't realize how much our field is changing. So what Zipia allows you to do for free is to type in a college major. I'm going to type in, let's say I want to go into an English pathway. Or let's go for math. I actually have an undergraduate degree in mathematics, so I appreciate this. So I type in the title of math as a college major, and then it starts showing me by how many people are actually employed in that offering per major. So in other words, if I major in math, what are the number of jobs that are most available in that? What does it make? All those types of things. Did you know that more math majors go into exactly what job title? Tell me. Software engineer. If I hit the plus sign on software engineer, it will start digging into it and tell me, what is the estimated salary? What are some of the names of the beginning titles of which I should apply for? I think, again, we put the students and teach them the content, but we do not give them the skills or the supplies to get the end goal. Good luck. And every once in a while, some of our fields might not be hiring as much. But if you ask their college professors, what's our response if we're in a field that's not hiring anymore? Sure, it's hiring. Why? I would like to keep my job. So what I would like to see is more guidance counselors, more teachers. I know I have some computing instructors in here as our largest number. Maybe if you're assigning a PowerPoint, have them use fields like Zipia.com and start to figure out their pathway. What does that look like? Put more thought into what your path is than what cool school you're going to go to, because that might only last 2, 4, or 17 years. So any of those things, we want to make sure they know their pathways. Well, I know from all the people at Cengage today, we can't thank you enough for being a part of this. And I close with absolutely the final video. You know, sometimes we hear that millennials are described as selfish snowflakes. We'll live forever in my basement. But I kind of think maybe it's not necessarily their fault. You say, why? We grew up telling them, you can be anything. And maybe a lot of us in here, we are the first generation that could have become anything. But yet, not everything is hiring. And sometimes what we're passionate about and that we love to do is simply called a hobby. Sometimes we really need to lay out in front of students, hey, here's the chances, here's the options. Pick up a couple of these classes too, you'll be more secure. But on the positive side, Google recently asked and looked at what millennials typed into the most into Google last year in 2017. I kind of find it heartwarming. And let's end with this. They live in a different world than we grew up in. They see things on the news that I can't imagine sometimes dealing with.
To the families and friends of the victims, know that we'll do everything we can. We are Vegas strong.
No matter what we're going through, we still have to push forward.
Are you ready to shake up the world?
Of love to realize we are all in this together.
We made history tonight.
Look at that!
It's emotional. I can't explain why, but it is.
I'm asking that you guys join and mobilize with me.
I will say it right now out loud. Me too.
Me too.
Me too.
Me too.
The things that make us different, those are our superpowers.
Go out there and conquer the world, because the world would not be as beautiful as it is if we weren't in it.
So what's your superpower? I teach. You too. Let's change the world. Thank you.